did you decide at what point that music was the direction you wanted to go in? Or did some, did you hear something? Or what? Or
am I first?
Inspired you? Yeah.
Okay. When I when he sent me that saxophone, and I was looking at all the big guys playing football and basketball and all of that, and I said, well, wait a minute. I can't do none of that. I'm too small. I better do something with the saxophone. You know, because I tried even to get up on a horse.
Wow.
And be a jockey. And that didn't work because the horse started galloping on me. And I jumped off and said, no more of that. Although my brother Percy, he would go out with his jockeys on and all this stuff and go horseback riding. He could do it, but not me. So I figured, like, at 5'2 or 3, man, the saxophone is for me. And the alto, I said, well, you know, like Lester said, he said it differently when he first got his saxophone. You heard what he said. It's on. It's on. It's taped. Mm-hmm. He said, "This bitch is for me, Press." Well, I felt the same way. This is for me, the saxophone.
So it was love at first sight, in a way.
Yes, and I used to go see all the big bands in Philly, and I admired Jimmy Dorsey. I heard him playing his theme that I loved so much, and I went to see them. At the Earl Theater in Philadelphia, I used to go see all the big bands. They were in vogue at that time. So you had to go see the big bands, Jimmy Lunsford, Benny Carter. And I went to see Glenn Miller. And they, I never forget this because they were playing Serenade in Blue. And they put the blue lights on the saxophone section. And I said, oh my God, that's what I want to be.
Yeah. Fell in love with
when I saw that. That section work. That's why I still love a big band. To hear people play together and blend. You know, so hopefully. I mean, I think the big band era just is with me forever.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
Yeah. First music I ever played was my teacher gave me Benny Carter transcriptions. Mm-hmm. So it was actually the first jazz solos I played. And then he gave me a tune by Ellington called Mood to Be Wooed.
Sure. Mm.
And I learned to play that. And wouldn't you know it, that the following, within a couple of weeks, Ellington's band came to Springfield. And all us kids, the Springfield Rifles, we all went to see Duke's band. We saw all the bands, of course.
Sure.
And Johnny Hodges stepped forward and he played Mood to Be Wooed. And I said the same thing. I said,
that's
for me. That's for me, you know. Yeah. And then I heard the first Charlie Parker record, Coco, you know.
Right.
And I brought it to Carmen, the Riveters. I brought it to rehearsal. I said, hey, kids, you got to listen to this. This is the greatest music ever, you know, with that kid band. Yeah. And they said, oh, you like this? Oh, that's awful. And I was in tears. I said, you're wrong. This is the greatest music in the world. And I quit. Mm. I quit the Riveters. My father was happy about that. But I mean, I took a stand for the music right from the get-go. But Bird put it all in focus.
And you left Springfield when you were 15 and moved to New York.
Well, I went to New York for lessons with Tristano.
Right.
With Hal Serra. Mm. We would go to Mr. Tristano's house, take a subway and a bus. It's about a 3-hour bus ride. And then, you know, go out to Long Island, take the lesson. And then we go back to town to Mainstem Records and buy all the latest 78s, you know, mm-hmm. Bird and Diz, whatever was hot. You know, 120 pounds of shellac.
Right.
And then get to Pasta and Romeo's on Broadway, you know, where you knew it was good because it was sitting in a big vatna in the window all day long, you know. Al dente was not in our vocabulary, you know. And then on to 52nd Street, get a Coca-Cola for a dollar. Mm-hmm. And that was, man, that was incredible, you know. And one time we went for a lesson, and Mr. Tristano said, are you guys going down to 52nd Street tonight? We said, why do you ask? And he said, well, I'm opening for Charlie Parker. I thought maybe you guys would like to meet him, you know. And to myself, I said, yeah, I always wanted to meet God, you know. So sure enough, well, this time we held back on the pasta so we'd have $2. So we could have two Coca-Colas because it was going to be a big night, you know. And the Tristano Trio opened up for the festivities. Mm-hmm. And after the set, somebody came and took us behind the the paper mache curtain. You know, the 52nd Street was all speakeasies. They were not really clubs. There was no dressing rooms. And there was Charlie Parker sitting on the floor with a big cherry pie. He said, "Hi, kids, want a piece of cherry pie?" And I said, "Oh, Mr. Parker, cherry is my favorite flavor." And it was, but I didn't know what to say. You know, he said, "Well, I'll get you a big slab." And he talked to us. And
how old were you?
15.
Whoa. Imagine that, meeting Charlie Parker.
And having a piece of cherry pie with him.
Bird.
With Bird. And he was so kind. I never forgot that. I mean, you don't read about that in the newspapers, you know, that don't sell papers. But he was always kind to young musicians. And I, even though I'm kind of getting, I can be grumpy at times, I try to, when I talk to a young musician, I try to be as kind as possible, you know.
I met you for the first time when I was 15, where I didn't get any cherry pie.
You didn't get no kindness?
I didn't get any cherry pie.
Oh, you didn't get no cherry pie?
No.
See?
I thought I was meeting God.
I was a natural. A natural pie eater.
So you did it, but you did it.